which is really a classic case of production management contract. So here everything is available to the farmer and all he needs to do is give up his land and his labor. So for him it's beneficial because it gets the market to his farm gate. He benefits from predetermined prices, assured inputs and supervision. And for the firm, now what's peculiar about the poultry industry is that I don't find that firms necessarily prefer large farmers. So they prefer a scale of between 3,000 to 20,000 chicks. And it's basically because they feel the management inefficiencies and mortality start increasing once you scale up. Also, they feel that small farmers probably more likely to strictly comply to rules and terms and conditions. I feel that the poultry industry is probably one industry where transaction costs of both the firms and the farmers can be overcome. And I find many prosperous farmers in this segment. So the next case study I'm looking at is contract farming for potatoes. So this is basically Banaskantha, where these huge companies like McCain and PepsiCo procure potatoes from. And I find that farmers can make about 600,000 from 2 hectares. There are a number of reasons why we would think that the scale of smallholder participation would be very limited in such scenarios. One of the reasons that I've already stated is transaction costs that companies face when they procure from a large number of small farmers. The other reasons could be quality and size considerations. So a lot of these companies tend to reject potatoes when they're very small or not of the required quality. And the third reason could be the drip irrigation component. So many of these companies have this prior mandatory requirement that you need to have a drip irrigation component, plus you need to move into much technologically advanced sort of farming system. So these could be three reasons why we would expect that smallholder participation to be limited. But I do find small and prosperous farmers here, and I find them in villages where there are already established linkages. So essentially, large farmers have already approached McCain, they've already established synergies with the companies, they've invested in cold storages, they turned into vendors, as well as they turned into dealers of irrigation systems. So this entire setup, this entire village where large farmers, medium farmers, small farmers are involved in contract farming, tend to produce many small and prosperous farmers. The third case study that I'll be looking at is peri-urban vegetable beds. And here, depending upon whether you're growing cauliflower or cabbage or tomatoes, your incomes can fluctuate by quite a bit, but they're all doing very well. Apart from all the factors that Sachin mentioned and Ganesh mentioned, which is superior water control, and here, of course, there's also proximity and connectivity to urban centers, what the farmers speak about specifically is how demonstration of profitability by large farmers in the village itself has helped them move from low value sort of cereals, cotton, wheat, paddy into very high value horticulture crops. The last case study that I'm looking at is NGO intervention of Sadhguru in Daho. Now, just like how Sachin and Ganesh put forward, I find that the degree of diversification areas where Sadhguru has operations is much, much higher than I find anywhere else. So there's 6 to 7 crops grown on 1.25 acres easily over the year. It's highly labor intensive agriculture, and they already have access to water control through these systems of lift irrigation and check dams, etc., that Sadhguru has been involved in for over 25 years now. And I also find that the shift to horticulture has been necessary, and I find farmers are selling both to wholesalers in Dahod as well as in weekly huts. I also find that what's really important is most of the small and prosperous farmers I find in the areas of Sadhguru's intervention are forerunners, and they're highly motivated. So that's also a really important factor. So I'd like to conclude by basically focusing upon the fact that when many farmers produce things in clusters, there are these mechanisms that come up. So in many of these areas, I find that farmers load trucks together, they deliver produce together, I find that shops come up, I find that they have access to crop health experts, to water consultants, and these things can happen when farmers produce things in clusters, and there are so many people involved in producing it. So there might be cooperative mechanisms somewhere much midway between individual farmers producing things and formalized cooperatives. So these options in a midway really need to be looked into and harnessed for smaller prospects. Thank you.